Hearst wired me from New York. The railroad combination in Washington's become too strong. Seems almost impossible to separate them now. Would you go over to Washington to meet the examiner? I told him I would do whatever it takes to stop Mr. Huntington's funding bill, and I will start for Washington Monday evening next. Callers, P. Huntington. Sole remaining appendage of the Bay Area Big Four. Tycoons, swindlers. They had included Mark Hopkins, Charles Crocker, and Leland Stanford. The latter three had, by then, mercifully passed. The Trans-Pacific and Union Pacific Railroads had been built using public monies. The railroad men had enriched themselves enormously at public expense, had failed to make anything more than token repayments of either interest or principal, an amount conservatively estimated at $75 million. Mr. Huntington's funding bill was a ruse, not merely intended to delay repayment for another 30 years, but to, in fact, be sure that the issue of repayment would never be enforced. The chief lobbyist for the corrupt and depraved contingent in Congress was one John Boyd, whom I refer to as Huntington's tapeworm. My first article began, "Mr. Huntington is not altogether bad. He tempers invective with falsehood. That is, although he says ugly things of the enemy, he is sure that they are mainly lies." Mr. Huntington appeared before the committee, and he took his hands out his pockets long enough to be sworn. The spectacle of this old man standing on the brink of eternity, his pockets filled with dishonest gold,
which he knew neither how to enjoy nor whom to bequeath, is one of the most pitiable it has been my lot to observe.
He knows himself an outmate in every institution in the world. He deserves to be hung from every branch of every tree, in every state and territory, penetrated by his railroads. I called him an inflated old pigskin, a veteran calumniator, promoted peasant. I called him the swine of the century. I met Mr. Huntington on the Capitol stairs. See, I had declined his hand in a committee session. It was once more offered, again met with stony rejection. Finally, he shouted, "Well, name your price." Every man has a price. That was the mauve decade. Once in the home of a Western family, who had recently acquired a vast fortune. I was admonished by the hostess to notice her spinal staircase. A year later, Mr. Huttington's funding bill was defeated, and I returned to San Francisco.